Welcome to Hearties One to One. Thank you for watching. My guest this week and joining me from Matchroom's Fight Camp is Scott Welsh. Scott, thank you very much for giving up your time and trouble this morning to join me on Hearties One to One. Let's kick straight off. How did you find boxing as a young man? How did you get into sport?
It's actually in my blood. My father was a boxer, a manager, promoter. I was a result of an affair, so I never met. I met him when I was older, when I was 20, 23, 24. I met him twice in my life. By that time, I had my sisters and brothers' father, so that's who I looked on as my dad. And the other guy, he was one of nine brothers, I believe, and so he already had a family, and he already had a family, and you know, I wasn't part of it, so I kind of held it against him a bit.
Because you were originally from Yarmouth, weren't you?
Great Yarmouth, yeah.
Yeah. So what brought you down to Brighton then, mate?
I was in trouble, and the guys that I was kind of mixing with, they got sentenced to prison, and I got my sister, who was living down in Brighton, and when I went to court, I told them that I'd moved to Brighton, turned over a new leaf, got friends down there and everything, and got a job, and I hadn't, and they sent me down there for the community service order. Yeah. So that's what brought me down there.
And you had that fateful, well, not a fateful meeting, a really significant meeting when you walked into the gym and met the late and much missed Dave Brown, who was your boxing mentor.
Yeah, I mean, Dave was a big part of my early career. The day I walked through the gym at 16 years old, he was a guy running it, him and an older guy called Chick and another guy called Roger, and they were massive. Part, but they've all passed now. But yeah, big part of my amateur background. Yeah, yeah.
And of course, you went on to win the coveted ABA title. What was that? I mean, you must have thought. I mean, that aside from going to the Commonwealth Games and the Olympic Games, that is the coveted prize for any amateur boxer in this country.
Yeah, I mean, the ABA title was a massive thing. They used to do it at the Albert Hall every year. I think Dave took me for the last 3 years running, and I kind of got my brain adjusted to this was the thing to win and to be part, you know, to then move on to a professional career. And I never really believed that I could achieve that. And I entered the competition. I entered in 91 and had a cold, and I knocked a guy down badly, and he got up and kind of beat me on the point. So that was my first time going in the ABAs, and then in the second one, I went through and knocked five out of the six out and won the title in 92 in style.
Yeah. Simple question to the uninitiated. You are the expert. What is the difference between amateur and professional boxing in mindset? Is it about training? Because when the professionals turn pro, they all start with four rounders, don't they, and six rounders before they build up. What's that mindset? What's that journey that an amateur boxer turning pro has to sort of take on?
Well, you're only used to boxing three rounds in the amateurs. So, you know, you start off on 3-2s, and then it switches to 3-3s. And when you fight 3-3s, it's totally different. You know, you put all your energies into three rounds, and then obviously you turn pro. You can then do four rounds, six rounds, eight rounds, 10 rounds, and then obviously the 12 rounds. Yeah. But you then have to keep that energy going for, you know, four rounds, six rounds, and that takes time. You can't just, I think, like what they do now, they've got the five or six round of the WSSB, isn't it? Which a lot of them do now before they go professional, which kind of is a professional at top level in the world now. So if you're kind of that high level, which I think Joshua and all them guys were, then they move on to the pros a lot easier. But in my day, it was a three rounder. As soon as you fight three rounds, you turn pro. You know that competition that I won was a three round competition. You win that, then you go on and do the pros. But I mean, it's like Nick Webb, who I trained. He won a competition called Ultimate Boxer, which was three fights in one night, basically an amateur style fight in the pros, and he won that. And he was a top amateur. He got to the final of the ABAs, won the fight, but never got the decision against an army guy. He dropped the guy two or three times in the fight. And I believe he never, well, we, anybody who watches the fight can see that he won the fight, but he didn't get the decision. No. So Nick was a good amateur as well. So it's just, I think being a good amateur is a good setup to then be a good pro. Yeah. It's not guaranteed, you know, but it helps a lot for most people.
Yeah. So. Can it work the other way though, Scott? Can you be not a bad amateur, but a sort of, you know, ones that's plodded, but you'll always be suited to the professional ranks with the increased training and the increased rounds?
Yeah, I mean, there's different guys in the pros now that are not had amateur backgrounds, but have taken to the pros very well. We're actually fighting one tomorrow night in Wardley, which is I think it was a four or six bout white collar fighter. Now, I think if we talk white collar, I mean, white collar, you could fight anybody. You know, you can bring take somebody off the street and just say, look, you know, we'll fight him. And, you know, that's not a good upbringing to kind of come through into the pros. Most of the kids that come through into the pros from white collar, where they haven't got that background, you know, they it's very hard for them to be an accomplished professional. But we'll see. I mean, listen, it happens. Webb's fighting Wardley. Yeah. Nick Webb's fighting Wardley. He's an accomplished amateur. He's going up against Wardley tomorrow night, and that's going to be interesting because, you know, they're singing big thing. Wardley's a good athlete. You can see he's a good athlete. He's got a punch. But you know, we'll see tomorrow night whether he can step up. But I mean, it's not guaranteed that you're going to be a good pro because you're a good amateur, and it's not guaranteed you're going to be a bad pro if you haven't had any amateur background. You know.
No. So, I mean, let's go back to your pro career. You'd obviously won the ABAs. By then, you were with the lovely Maria. You've had a stable family life. You're a grafter outside of the ring with your work. Was it a real culture shock going professional? Because you trained with Ronnie Davis for a bit, didn't you?
Yeah, I turned pro, I think, with Ronnie, and then in my third fight, I got a bad cut, 14 stitches over one of my eyes. I was winning the fight and got cut, and I think Ronnie said your career is kind of like done now. You know, that's going to open up and be a bad, going to cause you problems for the rest of your career. And it never opened up again. And I think the next nine fights I won by knockout and went on to have a successful career. But, you know, the pro career is a big step up, and it's a big mindset change. You know, you have to take your mindset and grow. You know, and believe in yourself and believe in what you do. I mean, I always believed that I could knock out anybody with my fists. You know, I wasn't so much. I didn't really believe that I was a good boxer, and there was so many better guys than me out there. But I believe that because of my belief in my power, that's what made me, and that's why I become a champion.
So, yeah. I mean, it all culminated with the war on the shore. I've still got that poster up in my loft. The War on the Shore at the Metropole in October 1995. A great night, mate, against the late James Owabola. I mean, that was, I wouldn't say it was the pinnacle of your career because you went on and you fought for a world title, but what do you remember about that night? It was an amazing night. I mean, one of the things before you give your memories, there was a little bloke there and it turned out to be Prince Nassim. Wasn't it? Having fun with people, this little bloke that no one had ever heard of. So, no, good stuff.
Yeah, no, that was I mean, obviously in 94, I fought James for a WBC international title on the undercard of Lennox Lewis in Atlantic City.
Yeah.
And he broke my jaw in the first round and then ended up knocking me out in the fifth round, knocking me down and separating me from my senses for a few seconds. And then after that, I was winning that fight. So for me, it was always about the return fight. I knew that I was better, or I believed that I was better than him. And he had a better night than me the first night. I think the snap, where he damaged my jaw, I knew that I couldn't. I mean, I tried to fight him at the start, and then I think I ended up boxing him because of the jaw. Every time I got close to him, you know, the jaw was in a lot of pain, and I couldn't tell my corner that I had a damaged jaw because I had a camera on me, and that would have obviously gone across to the TV. So each time they were pulling my gum shield out, I was like, in a bit of pain. But I think so that gave me the confidence in that first fight. I mean, James was a 6'9" Goliath. You know,
I've never seen a geezer like him. When he came into the ring. And it was almost because he was managed by Frank Maloney. I was going to say the late Frank Maloney, but formerly Frank Maloney, who later became Kelly Maloney, obviously. And when they came into the ring, it was like the Crankies, wasn't it? You know. But that was an amazing night. And then you pushed on. I remember the night of Tyson against Bruno too. You fought Bugner out in Berlin, the legend Joe Bugner. Then, to be fair, at the end of his career, although you did come out with a classic line, he said when you beat him, you were going to give him one of the bedrooms, one of the nice bedrooms in one of your old people's homes.
Yeah.
But how did you find him? Because he gave you some good advice there, didn't he, about...
Well, Joe Bugner was... Let's just understand what Joe Bugner did. Joe Bugner was an amazing fighter. And who was fighting in the 60s and 70s, I think, or 70s and 80s, 70s and 80s. And you know, just getting in the ring with him was an honour. And when I was told I was fighting him, I think he was 44 years old or something, and I was like, wow, you know, okay, this is going to be an easy fight for me. And I turned up at the press conference in London and I walked in and he was a big man. I mean, he was 6'4". I'm 6'2". He's 6'4". He was 18 and a half stone. I think I was about 56, maybe 16 stone or something. Yeah. I got a picture of me and him, and his fist was as big as my head. I've got my fist next to his fist. And I remember looking at his fist thinking, wow, that's a massive guy, you know, big guy, big hands. And I just thought, well, I'm a smaller, faster guy, and you know, I'll get rid of him very, very quickly. But he caused me a few problems. He had a world class jab that we had to work around in the training. I did get him. I got him in the fifth round. But absolute wonderful, wonderful man. We become dear friends afterwards. I'm still friends with his son now.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, he's not in good health. He lives in Australia. He's not in good health now. But It was an honour to share a ring with
Scott,
him.
Scott, you beat a man who'd gone 15 rounds and won with Henry Cooper. You beat a man that went 15 rounds with Muhammad Ali.
Yeah.
When Muhammad Ali was probably at his peak twice. So, you know, that's on your resume, Fraser, son. And Fraser.
Yeah, no.
So, no one can actually, you know, Bugner. But it brings me on to, and you say, sadly, that he's not in the best of health. And after boxing, you know, you are, I won't say you buck the trend because you've always, but you've acclimatized to boxing after. You know, you're all right, I have to put my hands up and say you're a dear mate of mine. You're very business savvy. You know what you're doing. You've got a very supportive family. You've got a loving family. But boxing is fraught with terrible stories. I mean, there's a great book, A Champion's Last Fight, which is by Nick Parkinson. And it's about all the horror stories after boxing. Your Ken Buchanan's, Lloyd Hunnigan's, people like that. And do you think previously, and I'm going to come on to WBC Cares, which is, I know, a project that you're very involved with. Do you think previously boxing as a sport has let its former fighters down after their careers are over? They've almost been forgotten. I remember you telling me a classic line, mate, about a classic promoter. When you win, he puts his arm around you. When you lose, he elbows you out of the way. Do you think a lot of boxers should have been helped more by promoters and boxing as a sport?
I honestly, I've spent a lot of years studying this game and trying to understand it. And it's a brutal game. It is a brutal game. I mean, we get in there. It's a wonderful for me. It still gives the guys with no hope. There's a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. Yeah. So, you know, if you've had a hard upbringing, you know, this is the easy sport to go into. You know, for me, it wasn't so much I had a hard upbringing, but I wanted to prove. I think that, you know, I wanted to prove it to my to the other family as well.
Yeah,
that I could do this. You know, but by the age that I really did do it, that had gone. You know, then I had my own reasons.
Yeah.
To box and you know, I was I've got a picture of me, I think 18 months old with a pair of gloves on with both my hands raised. So I believe I'm in this game for life. I can't walk away from it. I think if you cut me open, there's probably a glove, a red glove instead of a heart inside of me. But
it's about the pot of gold, Scott, though, you know, and we see many get that pot of gold, but it's the fact that there's always some shark that nicks their pot of gold when they've earned it. Or sadly,
it's a lot better now. But in the old days, yeah, definitely. I mean, you know, some of my dear friends, the older ones, you know, they've all passed now. So even from my career, they're damaged. There's a lot of damaged goods out there, and I believe that we're learning. We're educating people, and you know, we're in the 21st century now. So we should be. Using your hands as blocks as well as not just punching. Yeah, this kind of stuff is 18th, 19th century. And I believe that this is where it's at now. So you do exactly the same, but you catch shots instead of just holding them like this. It's not just about the punching. It's about defending and keeping these shots away from your head. And I think that's still not fully across the sport yet. There's still a lot of people and a lot of kids, even the training side of it, they're still teaching them just to punch and not defend themselves. But it's definitely better. You know, we're still getting brain injuries and we are still getting a few deaths here and there, unfortunately. But that's in every sport, in horse riding, in
motor racing. Everything.
Motor, you know, in every sport.
Everything. Tell us a bit about WBC Cares, because I know it's a project that you're really involved with, and you're sort of one of the commissioners on the WBC now, aren't you?
Yeah, chairman of the WBC Cares in the UK. I mean, again, that come around after James' death. I'd done some work. Done quite a bit of charity work and they got in contact with me and after James passed and said, look, Scott.
Yeah. I mean, sadly, James was murdered, wasn't he? James was working on
it. Yeah,
some stroke came and shot him, you know, for no reason.
You know, he's a doorman but so they said, look, we want to present you with a WBC belt that you fought for with James and we'd love you to be involved and try and you do good work and we'd like you on board to share the good work with the WBC. And that was back in 2016 or two I think 208, they give me the belt. I was working with them for about 7 or 8 years, and then they made me the chairman in 216. And since then, we've done a lot of great work. We do a lot of the work we use at Risk. We're doing disability boxing, wheelchair boxing. We work with the blind as well. We do boxing with the blind. We're working across all the factors, and it's really, really, really good.
Scott, that is absolutely amazing that they've now got all these facets for the people that would normally have not got near boxing, wheelchair boxing, blind boxing. But more importantly, all those young lads, and you talk about that young 16-year-old tear away from Great Yarmouth coming down to Brighton to do his community service. How many people's lives are the WBC cares changing for the better? I mean, ultimate legacy, mate.
Yeah. Just before lockdown, we were dealing with about 750 kids. So we're just getting all that back in place now. Now we're coming out. So... So we just want to help as many as we can across the board.
But if you just sit back, Scott, if you just sit back and think 750 kids not getting in trouble, not going to prison, not having the probation service looking after them, you think of the money that you're actually saving the state just with your work. It's amazing, mate.
Thank you.
Hopefully in 2 years' time, it'll be 1,500 kids. It'll be everything. There is one kid that I want to talk about, your lad Tommy, who's now a professional, won in Italy on Saturday night. How is that going? And it must be a little bit of a culture shock for you, being both father and coach.
Yeah, I mean, it's something, again, that he's been bought. He's been born into it. So all his life, he's had boxing around him. He's seen me training a lot of different kids. He knows what we want. He knows what it takes to be successful in this game. He knows that you only get out what you put in. So I didn't think he was going to go professional. He had a great junior amateur career, kind of went a bit AWOL in the seniors, kept coming back saying, yeah, he's going to do it. And then there was just too many distractions for him and too much going on in the outside world. And he finally, lockdown came. He said to me, Dad, I want to be a professional. And I said, yeah, okay, well, we'll see when you up the training and everything. He's got a great guy, a Royal Marine guy, Ben. Ben, who's basically been training with for the last 3-4 years, and he's kind of kept him in a great place. And then they started training and said to me, he's going to be ready in September, October time. And that was last year. And then we got him ready. I think he had his debut in December. And it's been nonstop since. But he's a different animal now. He's training really, really well and putting everything together. He understands it and knows exactly what's got to be done, and he's training hard. And so I think the difference is between me and him is I never had a kind of a mentor. I've spent so long this game studying it, and it's easy for me now just to tell him all the pitfalls and all the way to go. So he's got a master behind him. And you know, I believe that's a fantastic thing for him. And I think he can go as far as he wants to go, you know?
Yeah. So we'll get a war on the shore at the Metropole, hopefully soon.
We definitely will. That's coming. Make no mistake about it.
Great. And a fight at Falmer at the football ground. That would be good.
Yeah, absolutely.
Nick Webb. Let's just go back to Nick Webb, because I know that you've... Not transformed Nick Webb's career, but as we've seen with many boxers, that they start out and then, you know, they don't have any different time. I remember Mickey Aldis up at Crawley suddenly developed, you know, with a different trainer. You've transformed Nick Webb's career. He's fighting Fabio Wardley. What after Wardley? So you're fighting in Barry Hearn's back garden tomorrow night. So, do you think Nick will knock Wardley out?
I believe that. Listen, I'm not one to say that we're going to do this and that. We train hard. We train. We know what we're doing. Nick knows this is a really tough fight for him. But it's not, you know, it's a tough fight because of the stage that it's at. We're the underdog. We're in the wrong corner,
yeah,
so to speak. So we've got everything going against us. You know, I believe that the referee, you know, that they'll probably jump in very, very quickly if he gets hit with a shot, as yeah, you know, because it's their own corner. So yeah, so we've got a few things up against
us. They call it, don't they? A hometown fighter, they call it.
Yeah. So we've got to win big to win, you know.
Now,
Nick's at the stage of his career where he needs to win. We're still looking at another fight with Dave Allen. So if we can get through tonight, then that'll still be on the cards.
Yeah, right. I'm going to ask you a question because you're a proud Brighton & Hove citizen. You weren't born here, but you know, you live on Shoreham Beach and you've done a lot for Brighton & Hove. There's a stat here, Scott. In 1981, on this day in 1981, there were over 15 boxing clubs in the Brighton & Hove area. It's now down to single figures. Would Brighton & Hove be a better city if we had more boxing, more chance for people to channel their aggression?
Well, I think the difference now is you've got a lot of gyms that have boxing inside them.
Yeah.
So they're not necessarily amateur boxing gyms,
yeah,
as they used to be, but you've got a lot of gyms. I mean, there's a lot of boxing in Brighton.
There's still a lot of boxing in Brighton, which is good.
Yeah. I mean, there's
so you don't look at those figures and say, oh, there's only X, Y, Z clubs.
No. That's the amateur side. The amateur side is unfortunately getting harder and harder. I've known it's been really tough for the last few years. I mean, they don't, you know, there's no kind of funding available to kick that. You know, we all used to give time as trainers for free. Nobody wants to give time for free anymore. It's all, everybody wants to get paid. Life's a faster life now. So it's a different world. You know, we haven't got the time, or people haven't got the time to give their time for free. We've still got a few coaches that do, but it's getting harder and harder. And to give up their times 3-4 times a week. You know, Dave Brown, the likes of Dave Brown, that world, that, you know, they were, I mean, he had a butcher's shop and would work till 6 every night, come straight down the gym, and two to three nights a week. And then he'd say, right, we're boxing Wednesday, Thursday. You know, it's your whole life. And now as amateurs, people want their lives back. So they're not doing it. It's very, very hard.
You know,
so,
and I know that you gave him a WBC award. Thankfully, he received it before he sadly passed on. But if anybody was worthy of an MBE, it would have been Dave. How it never got picked up is ludicrous.
Yeah.
Scott, you've given up your time. I really do appreciate it. I'm going to bring a camera crew down because I want to see this wheelchair boxing and this blind boxing. I think it's an amazing project that you do. Thank you for all you do for the community, and I'll see you soon. Take care, mate.
Thank you very much, Ian. Thank you very much, guys. Superb.
Really interesting stuff from Scott there. Thank you for watching. I'll see you next time. Take care.